You know, it's funny, when I talk to other church musicians, and even friends who are in church or music, they look at what we do and go, it must be a very exciting thing to do. And for me, I don't think of myself as an artist, I think of myself as a composer. And frankly, it's just about writing and writing and writing, and every so often one thing comes out that isn't as bad as the rest. I only record something if I really think it has something unique about it. And so when I record something or write it down by hand in manuscript paper, that is a symbol that I think this could go somewhere. And we reckon of all those tunes, probably about 1 out of 110 actually gets published. You know, so I work so hard to get small results. But I don't think anything in life is achieved without sacrifice, whether you're a church musician, whether you're a choir director, whether you're a choir member. I think often in church music, where we don't have success, we deserve the lack of success because we haven't pushed ourselves to the levels that we could. We've settled for too low standards. And I think in the day and age we live, for choirs to flourish, you know, they have to have leaders who have a big vision, who have high expectations, and who understand the value of choral singing, both for the musical dimensions, for the theological and spiritual and church dimensions, but also for the wider social dimensions as well. In my case, it's nearly all music first. I go after melodies. Each song has arrived in a different way. One last year actually arrived when I was in the golf course. So I've been encouraging my friends to tell my wife that Keith needs to spend more time on the golf course. It would be good for him. So my wife hasn't bought it yet. When I write a hymn melody for the church, that is my gift to the church. So for example, if you listen to Scandinavian versions of Across the Lands, the melody changes a little bit. I don't particularly like it, but it's become popular in Scandinavian, so that's what it is. Similarly, In Christ Alone is one of the most sung religious songs in China today. And again, the version of it, or the versions of it, are all very different. So I am not coming into this to impose my musical superiority. I'm coming to try and write melodies that allow words to live and allow masses of people to sing together and join them together. And then how they go from there is interesting. But I think that's what it is to be a modern songwriter as well, and a global songwriter, is when you write a classic melody that actually is able to penetrate all the stuff that's out there and reach around the globe. Part of the joy is hearing the different versions and the different interpretations of it. You know, that's a really special. I consider that a real privilege to get to hear that. So, in the same way as being a church musician, and my wife and I give 12 weeks a year to touring. So we do 60 events a year, and we get to hear all the different ways churches sing it. How a church in Lancaster sings a song, Lancaster, Pennsylvania sing a song, is actually different than how they sing it in Europe, or how they sing it in, even how they sing it in some parts of America. How they sing it at a gathering of 91 nations in New York. Or indeed, the funniest one was when the Archbishop of Canterbury, at his enthronement, used In Christ Alone as the hymn of the enthronement. And of course, it was Canterbury Cathedral Choir, London Symphony, and it was a wonderful, glorious occasion in the cathedral with the royal family there and everything. And it was a formal, basically high church pipe organ-driven hymn version of In Christ Alone with lots of chord changes. And all my friends were going, "Can you believe In Christ Alone could sound like that?" And I went, "I actually wrote it like that." It was everybody else had to simplify it so it worked in modern churches. So it's just gone back to its original version. It became 15 years old this year, so.